Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE's live coverage of AWS reInvent. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. We're here for 3 days of wall-to-wall coverage. It's our 13th year covering reInvent. We've seen it from the early days when it was just a small little cloud, some basic building blocks and primitives, abstracting away servers and infrastructure. Now we're seeing the agent era coming where the ability to abstract out the data and prepare the new infrastructure to automate work and abstract out work and all that heavy lifting. Clint Sharp is here as the co-founder and CEO of Cribl. He's doing a lot of work in this area. He's been a leader in the infrastructure side with data. Clint, great to see you again. It's almost a tradition every year at reInvent. We sit down and you give us the scoop on how the data pipelines are going, who's moving what around, what's the infrastructure look like. Great to see you.
That's great to be back, John.
So on my little preamble there, I want to get your thoughts on this because one of the things we've been covering in New York at the NYSE studio in Palo Alto and the events is it seems like the enterprise is like stuck in the mud here on agentic and AI. Security resilience bars are high. Everything's in POC mode, one-year contracts. There's no ARR, there's no R, final R on it. It's an annual revenue. It's not a recurring. So you see kind of like people trying to figure out what to do. It's almost as if they're not ready yet. And Amazon, actually pretty strong announcements with Nova half-baked, with your data. Okay, that's cool. Frontier agents, that sets a direction. If this continues, the enterprises now will have a path to get some wins and some ROI, but they've got to be set up for it. What's your view on this? I know you have an opinion on this.
Yeah, so I think one of the fascinating things that we've observed, and we're in 49 of the Fortune 100, we're in 30% of the Fortune 500, so we sell primarily to the upper end of the market, is the disconnect between the top level, so their CEOs are, we're all in on AI, right? Yeah. And then as you start to talk to the people trying to procure AI solutions, their lawyers and their compliance departments, no AI. Nothing, get AI out of these agreements. We can't buy anything with AI in it right now. And so they're eventually going to get there. But what they're going to find once they get there, and I've been talking to a lot of CISOs, a lot of CIOs, and I'm like, hey, look, agents are going to be the future. Eventually we'll be able to eliminate a lot of kind of your tier one, analysts, and we'll be able to kind of 10x investigate, turn them into 10x investigators, make them way, way, way more productive. But if I need to quadruple or quintuple your logging infrastructure in order for you to get that benefit, does that ROI work out? And they laugh because they're already spending tens of millions on this. If I have to spend $50 million on it, I'm not spending.
Explain that.
Million.
Explain that point because this is a really key. This is the promise and the dream on one end, and then the reality on the numbers. Explain that again about the cost of the logging. Just explain that.
Well, so, I mean, Cribl, since its inception, we're solving this problem of data growth. Your data is growing at a 30% CAGR, your budget is not, and what got you to 2025 is not going to get you to 2035. And so the reason why we even came into existence and the problem that we solve is that customers are like, if I keep trending this way, I'm already spending $10 million a year on my logging infrastructure. In 5 years, I'm going to be spending $25 million, but my budget isn't going up like that. So I need to do something different. This problem is slightly different in that agents are so productive. So as they're doing their investigations, they're going off, and for every one hypothesis that a human would run, they're running 10 or 50 hypotheses.
So they're throwing off more exhaust, data.
They're generating more queries. And so you have to, if you talk to people about their infrastructure, it's not like they're running their infrastructure at 10%. They're running their infrastructure at 80, 90% because it's already so expensive that I can't just have idle infrastructure.
They're clocking it up as fast as they can.
And so if I then go generate 5 times, 10 times, 20 times more queries, I'm going to need that much more infrastructure in order to accommodate that workload. And so that's where the ROI is going to mismatch, is that the promise is like, hey, it's going to do the work of humans so much faster than what humans are going to do. But the humans are generating queries today. They're logging into search bars and typing in terms and trying to find bad actors and find problems and all that sort of stuff. Agents are going to do the same thing. They're just going to do it at a much more rapid clip. So we've been talking a lot about agentic telemetry as the future and trying to get your infrastructure ready to get to a modern lakehouse architecture. The data needs to be structured rather than unstructured. It needs to have a well-understood semantic model so that the agents will be able to understand the data. It's not just a soup of text. It actually is structured into fields and with a well-known schema. And if you start working now, by the time your lawyers and compliance people allow you to go procure an agent, then you'll be ready to go get the benefits of kind of our future agentic future.
So AI telemetry, if I hear you properly, is the setup for AI, meaning you got to understand what's going on, and that's going to still need to be logging data too, right? I mean, explain that further. I might need to understand that because is it the same as observability or is it different?
Yeah, so I mean, it is a update to our view of observability and security. And what we're saying is, okay, the agentic future is coming, but agents are a little bit different than humans.
Yeah.
So as an example, in my own data warehouse, when I go to my BI tool and I ask it questions like, hey, how much revenue do we make by segment? Inside of my data warehouse, I have 6 fields called ARR. And so which one does it, it gives me a different answer every time. And like, that's not what I want. I want it to be consistent and deterministic and reliable. And so like, we're gonna have to do this same type of work for security data, for observability data. Instead of kind of pouring a soup full of logs that is just completely unstructured, we didn't do any prep work to it, we just loaded it in there so that we could search it and get it back. And a human can read that and a human can reason about it. And a human can say like, I read the log, it makes sense to me, it's not well parsed, it's not structured that well. But AI and agents are not that intelligent. And we're not gonna wanna customize them so heavily for every enterprise. We're going to want to be able to have these agents work out of the box. And so we're going to have to do a lot of work to structure that data on the way in so that the agents will have a rich understanding of the data model and be able to give back the correct answers to these questions.
So the Cribl Lakehouse is what you guys have, right? So what is it different? What's modern about that? Explain the difference between kind of the legacy or modern, I call it modern legacy version of that. What's the upgrade with Cribl Lakehouse versus the others?
Yeah, so we're bringing general purpose data technology, the type of technology that Snowflake, Databricks are building for business data, but we're bringing that to the telemetry space. And there's a lot of work in abstracting away data engineering. Mm-hmm. So one of the problems that IT and security buyers have is that I have about as many people running my data warehouse as I have in my security department. And that makes sense because they're doing a lot of data prep work and ETL jobs and getting all the data loaded and structured and building reports and all that stuff. But my security team's about the same size and their job is to secure everything. Like they have to handle all the identity, they have to understand, you know, all the vulnerabilities and the remediations, and they also have to ask questions of their log data. And so if we need to have a data prep team that's as equal in size today as the people doing all of security, that ROI just doesn't.
That's not even possible.
It just doesn't work out, right? And so, you know, really what we're doing with our lakehouse is we're saying, hey, we're going to give you the benefits of what you would get out of a cloud data warehouse, a lakehouse technology, separated storage compute, very fast query execution, but we're giving you that for telemetry data. So we're abstracting away the concepts of tables. We're abstracting away, you know, all of the data prep work that you need to do. You can think of it like you thought of the solutions from 10 years ago. You can just pour data at it. You don't have to do any work, but we're going to give you the properties and the performance.
So you're using AI agents to one, make the data lake better. Is that right?
So we're doing a lot of work on the data prep side. So building parsers so that you don't have to go build all of those.
So when you say dump your data in, you say just give it up. Don't have to worry about it.
Like, right. Just pour it at us and make
so
it our job.
Prepping the data on the way in.
Yeah. Absolutely, absolutely. Sure. Hundreds of parsers, out-of-the-box structuring, normalizing to industry standard schemas like OCSF or OpenTelemetry. But we get the data come in and automatically put it into a format that's going to work really well to give you very fast query, but also very cost-effective performance because the volumes of data in telemetry are orders of magnitude greater than business data. So if you look at a Snowflake petabyte data warehouse, that's a big customer for them.
Yeah.
My larger customers are moving a petabyte of data per day, and they're retaining data for a year. And so you really need to customize and build things specific for the telemetry market to make it work cost effectively.
And you think that's going to feed the main neural systems of the agents, if you might word, but like basically be the key for the agents to perform.
Yeah, and so then the agents are going to layer on top. And so we are building agentic technology that will help you, you know, work, you know, kind of marry this human-generated data. So if you look at how people troubleshoot, right? Like something goes wrong. There's a Slack channel created, there's a Jira ticket created, or ServiceNow ticket created. They go start browsing a bunch of wikis, trying to figure out if there's runbooks and things like that, right? what agents are going to do is marry all that with your telemetry data. And so we're building that. And then there's also other companies building that. I don't know if you, you know, Resolve AI is a, yeah. has a huge booth out there, right? Like yeah. they're going into this space. ServiceNow is going into this space. But ultimately, all of these agents are going to need data. And we are the company that's providing the plumbing and the infrastructure that's going to make it both performant and cost effective to have access to all of this data.
All right, so for people watching out there that are in this mode of, they're super excited, they see what Amazon is announcing. It's clear that it's AI or die market. I mean, clearly AI is here for a long, long time. What do they need to do to get ready? I mean, give your advice on how to set the table for agentic to gun right, because that's the number one conversation here at this week is like, what's the foundational thing? Now, Amazon has things like Connect that was built from the ground up because they built their own stuff, but not everyone's going to have that capability, but now they need to start thinking about what that looks like.
Yeah, I think we have to consider that agents are really good at doing things that were a path a human has already treaded, right? Something that a human has done before. And so it's going to make investigations way, way, way more productive. It's going to make humans way, way, way more productive. But in order to do that, you're going to have better quality data. And telemetry data today, I mean, it's kind of an open secret, but it's mostly garbage. Like most of it doesn't get read back. So we're going to have to get really good about deciding which of this data we want to onboard, getting it well structured, and deciding how we can make it ready for agents to be able to interpret it.
You know, one of the things, as you mentioned, the garbage data telemetry that I'm seeing in kind of the AI factory kind of vibe with NVIDIA with simulation. You're starting to see simulation environments get built just to handle the garbage. Like it's like the wastewater treatment plant. And so it's all this stuff. And agents are going to throw off more code. They're going to do a lot more things to track. So your point about data, I mean, we're seeing it with vector embeds. I mean, just words now have context. That's more storage. So like, there's more data coming from this. So what's your view on simulation, these environments? Is it... am I off the reservation, or
well, I think one of the things that you said that hits at that point is your data was growing in a 30% CAGR in a pre-AI era, right? Yeah. So like, I'm already breaking the bank today.
Yeah.
And what's going to happen? And so you can think of telemetry data as this exhaust from machine to machine interactions, but it usually starts with a human, right? Yeah. Like the you know, I open up an app on my phone, you know, I rebook an airline ticket, right? Behind the scenes, there's all this log data that's generated. Every time I click from screen to screen, there's data being generated. Now imagine that's an agent doing that for me, but it's doing it at warp speed. And so how much more data are we going to end up with? So back to agents.
By the way, on the telemetry side, there's one thing, but just when agents be functional, these are transactions. It's almost micropayments, OLTP-like conditions. That's actually needs to then go to a system of record.
Yep.
That's more data. It's like, again, just telemetry aside, agents will throw off more data.
The data growth problem is not going away. And the cost challenges, like the budgets are not going to increase at the rates of data volume increase. So like what ultimately are we going to do? We're going to have to get smarter.
Yeah, that needs a radical solution. Data gravity is still the problem.
Well, that kind of brings me into my data pawns sort of thing, which is that you know, I think we thought we're going to bring all the data together, right? Like and data lakes became a thing. We're going to put all the data into one big data lake. But what my customers are telling me is that like, hey, I've got a data lake from vendor A, B, and C. Why do I have to pay to move it and centralize it? And so one of the things that we're doing with our search technology is federation, and we do it really, really well. And we think that the future is I want one lens on all of my data. I want one lens, but I don't want to care whether it's in a vendor's cloud, if it's in my cloud, if it's in my data center. And we think that that's going to be a key capability going forward, especially as we start to look at agents need one lens on that data. Like, do I want it to configure an agent to talk to all my different data lakes, or do I want one tool that can figure out how to talk to all of them right?
Well, that makes sense, because why move the data? It's already landed somewhere.
I'm paying for it.
Yeah, it's sitting there.
And now I have to pay for another copy just so that I can query it from, you know, from one central place. But that seems excessive to me. If we can federate, then we can save ourselves a ton of infrastructure.
Clint, always great to chat with you again. You always have the finger on the pulse. I think you're right. The data prep, in quotes, not the old definition, preparing for AI is definitely real on the agentic. I guess in general for your business, talk about your business, how things going on the business front. revenue, momentum? Can you share some stats on what's going on?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, the business is growing, you know, at 50% year over year. We announced last year, or I think it was earlier this year, that we had surpassed $200 million in ARR. You can do the math in terms of how quickly, you know, that's growing. We're continuing to grow at a very, very rapid clip. We're beyond 1,000 employees now, well over 1,200 customers. Yeah. Already mentioned the Fortune stats. I mean, like the business is growing at an incredible rate.
A lot of big enterprises.
We love selling to big companies. I mean, and it's just because
they have a problem too, and that's the problem space.
And I think a lot, like, in Silicon Valley especially, like, people like to get started selling to startups. They make decisions fast.
Yeah.
They're smart people. They're future looking. But, you know, the real money's in the enterprise. And so we have the patience, and we also have the understanding of their problems. Like, in the enterprise, nothing ever goes away.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I like to joke that, like, the whole thing stood up by a server sitting under somebody's desk. You accidentally kick that thing, everything comes crashing to a halt. Because, like, they've made a lot of choices over the years, and we really...
They're brittle, but don't kick it. That's just, don't touch it.
Just
leave it alone.
Yeah, there's probably already a sticky on it that says, don't touch this.
But password, because the person died.
Yes, you know? Password is password, right? Like but we understand their challenges, yeah. And as a customer's first company, we just love supporting them.
Yeah, and the enterprises have the need. Matt Garman quoted on his keynote, 80% to 90% of the value is going to come from the enterprise with the Agentic. So, good tailwind for you guys. Congratulations. Great to see you. Thanks
great
for coming
to see you.
Breaking it all down here again. The data problem doesn't go away, even with pre AI. AI will throw off more and more data. If you don't have a strategy for it, you won't be ready to have the agentic workflows, of course, doing our part to bring you the data here. Thanks for watching.